Thank you. Thank you for the chance to be here and present this short, condensed version of my RSA presentation on search engine poisoning. I'm Chris Larsen. I'm the malware research team lead with Blue Coat Systems. And 2 years ago, I came to RSA and did a presentation on search engine poisoning. And at that point, I felt like I'd covered the material, it could be put to bed, I could move on to other things. And then this past year, something happened that made me realize, no, it's time to take another look at this, and that's the research I'll be presenting today. So at the risk of totally stealing the thunder of my presentation, this is why the bad guys are so successful with search engine poisoning. Number one, there's just tons of people go there. It's the number one destination as a category of website on the internet for traffic. It's a lot of potential victims. The users that are going to a search engine, they don't know where their data is that they want to get to. That's why they're on the search engine, right? They're searching. And so they're more likely to click on things. That's what they're there for. And also, they trust the search engine not to have bad stuff in it. And on the technical side, there's a built-in hackability. We sometimes talk about SQL injection attacks, where you use the website to attack the database behind it and then to infect the users later. And if you think about it, the search engines have built-in hackability. They let you, as the bad guy, serve them a page, inject a page when their indexer comes and crawls the site. You say, here, search engine, read this. Then later, the search engine serves that page in the form of the URL back to a user who is visiting the site and searching for that. When they click it, the user comes to your site. You can now give them a totally different page from what you showed the search engine. So it's a perfect attack. There's also just a lot of clutter. If you think about it, good guys and bad guys alike want their page to show up in the top page, the top 10 results. And there's so much of that search engine optimization, SEO, activity going on. It's a huge haystack, and it's hard for the search engines to keep the needles out of the haystack. Now, in the old days, a few years ago, when I was researching search engine poisoning, it was kind of fun because it was easy to find the search engine poisoners. For one, they were large-scale operations. They would have huge sets of websites hosting thousands and thousands of bogus pages to feed to the search engines. They had to do this so that they could cover a wide area of possible search terms, and also those pages could reinforce each other and convince Google and Bing, hey, these are valuable pages. Look at all the things that link to it, right? They're also very active in spamming links to those pages out on the web. Essentially, they were shouting, hey, Google, index me, index me. And for a search engine poisoning researcher, you could essentially just listen for the sound of the search engine poisoner shouting to the search engines and find them that way. In particular, we had a lot of fun looking for dangerous searches. We had it's a little game we would play in the office on the malware team, where you'd try to find a set of words you could put into a search engine, and most of the links that came back in the top 10 would be malicious. I mean, a perfect 10 was hard to do, but we did get it a couple of times. And we actually thought this would be a fun research project that would probably get us into a security conference somewhere, to take a bunch of those dangerous searches and compare Google and Bing and Yahoo and Baidu and some of the other search engines and be able to say, we're here to tell you that the most dangerous search engine on the web is Baidu or whatever. That was a pretty labor-intensive project, though, so we never actually did it. And over the time, the last couple of years, search engine poisoning has evolved. And one example that's kind of fun is image search engine poisoning. In the old days, it was text-based. You type in your text, get the poison search page, click on a link. Then the bad guys realized that there was this untapped gold mine of search engine poisoning to be done in the image searches. I know my kids, actually, it's more common for them when they're doing their homework to go into Google image search and look for a picture that they need for a report than it is to go and actually search for text. This is an example from our blog. And the attack was based on people searching for a Japanese anime series about this clan of ninjas that apparently can do magical powers. And when they do the magical powers, their eyes turn red and they get these cool patterns in their iris. And so these are images from that anime series. And the interesting thing about images is they're hard for computers to process. The search engines are really good at handling large volumes of text and indexing that text and parsing text, but those skills don't help with images. Pictures are harder. And I use this example because there is a lot of cultural knowledge embedded in this. For example, One of the four images that have the red links underlined there, those are the malicious ones. One of the four doesn't fit, and it's kind of the Sesame Street. You know, one of these things is not like the other, and it's because it's a normal-looking eye, right? So that wouldn't be one of these ninjas, right? They don't have normal-looking eyes. The other thing, though, that was more interesting to me was that all four of the poisoned results here are hosted on hiphopblog.com. And if you think about, this is the universe of hip-hop fans on the internet, and this is the universe of Japanese anime fans on the internet. There's not a lot of overlap in those two worlds, right? And so you wouldn't expect, if you think about it for a few seconds, you wouldn't expect these images to be showing up legitimately from a hip-hop blog. But how would a computer know that? So that's just one example of how the landscape evolved. But in general, as we would play our little game to see if we could find a lot of dangerous links, it was getting harder to do that. And so we said, hey, the search engines are winning. Yay, Google. And so we moved on to research other things. And then last summer, something happened. And this is what happened. We did our mid-year report on the state of malware on the web. And this particular chart just whacked me in the face. And what this is a look for the first time at attack vectors. So we said, these are where the attacks begin. Okay, and search engine poisoning, the jaggedy blue line at the top, is bigger than all the other little vectors put together. And I said, wow. Still, the bad guys are still doing so well with search engine poisoning that there's that many attacks doing that? What are they up to? And that's where the research began. So to see where the data came from, if you think about this, again, the users are not setting out on their computers deliberately to find malware. They're doing something else, and the malware happens. And so since a typical attack is structured with a number of sites that relay in kind of a chain, we say, okay, we'll start at the pointy end of the stick, the actual malware being served, and say, what site led the user to that site? And so you trace back, and then you say, okay, now how did the user get there? And if you trace back three or four steps, you usually hit a trusted, well-known sort of site. That's the starting point. And so you say, okay, this was a search engine. This was a webmail site. This was social networking. That's where this attack began. And I couldn't resist throwing this in just because it's really cool. This is a chart, a graph actually, that's produced by our tool that traces the attacks back. And this is a snapshot of one particular network of bad guys in one day, and it's the attacks that they're launching. And the big red cluster at the top is a search engine poisoning attack. There are other attacks this same network is running involving spam, malvertising, porn, and a few other things going on. And the little arrows that link all this together are some of the sites, the infrastructure in the background that links this whole network together. And that's the level of visibility you need if you're going to go in and gather good data for a research project. So, what are the bad guys up to these days? Why is it working so well for them? Well, I started off with that idea from 2 or 3 years ago that it'd be really fun to compare a bunch of search engines and see how they did against the same kind of searches and say, who's the safest? As I started out that way, it turned out not to be very interesting because I didn't get very far into that project and I realized that Bing had caught up with Google. See, 2 years ago, Google was measurably safer than Bing, and that's not true anymore. However, Baidu, which is the big Chinese search engine, and Yandex, which is the big Russian search engine, are still way worse, way more dangerous to be searching for stuff there. And in fact, there's still, if you drill into the actual bad links that are showing up there, a lot of these are what I would call old school SEP. They're the kinds of stuff you'd see 2-3 years ago that were fooling everybody. Google and Bing have moved past that. They're not fooled by those kinds of pages anymore. These guys still are. This time around, I looked at Google Hong Kong and Russia to compare to Baidu and Yandex. Both of Google's foreign language sites did better than the native language competitor. But interestingly, they did slightly worse than Google.com, the English language Google. And this was true across the board as we looked at search engines from different languages, different countries, and for non-English content, even within Google and Bing. The algorithms that people have developed to screen out the junk sites are not as mature, if they exist at all, in languages other than English. The other thing that was interesting is, and there's a fun story here, I cheated partway through. And this researcher was not as unbiased as he should have been. There's a site called caninesafesearch.com that's built by Bluecoat's canine team. And K9 is the free software that we give out to families originally to keep porn away from their kids. Nowadays, it's good for malware too. But the K9 Safe Search team was disturbed that you could go into Google or Bing and do an image search on a safe topic and still get adult pictures even with Safe Search turned on. And so they said, we're going to build a safer image search. And so I said, okay, well, for fun, I'll put them in the comparison of the search engines. And in the very first day or two, I noticed there was a lot of bad stuff on dynamic DNS sites. And I said, hey, guys, if you will strip those results out of your search engine, you'll be safer than on malware too. And they were. And they scored higher than Google and Bing. So in the interest of full disclosure, Microsoft and Google, if you're listening, strip out the dynamic DNS and you too will be a safer search. So that wasn't as interesting for me because, like I said, the conclusions came out of the data so quickly there wasn't much else to study. And so I shifted focus and started looking at instead, are there common patterns in the things people are searching for when they get fooled by one of these links and click it that we can look at? And so we have a tool that as we're auto-tracing back to see where the attack came from, we hit a search engine, we say, okay, chalk up one more search engine attack. But we say, as long as we're there, can we parse out the terms that the user actually typed in that led to that result that they clicked on that was taking them to malware? And so I pulled out a sample set of about 2,300, a little over that, collected over mostly October, November last year. And this is what kind of the categories were. And we'll go through this in a couple of slides so you don't have to try and memorize all the percentages. So the first thing that jumped out at me was almost half of the searches, even though I tried to break out the ones I thought were the most common areas that showed up a lot, still almost half the searches, 42% miscellaneous. This is just everything else. Literally every topic you can think of and a whole bunch you can't even imagine, there's somebody searching for that on Google and Bing and whatnot. And more amazingly, there's a bad guy who was there ahead of them and has a page already crafted to convince the search engine, this is what you should show that person as a top result. It's just amazing. So that's the big thing. Interestingly, the second most popular category, if you will, for search engine poisoning attacks, non-English. 2-3 years ago when I was doing SCP research, it was very rare for me to come across a network of sites set up to do this that had non-English content. It was almost always English. Now almost a fifth of the searches that got people in trouble were in other languages. Many of the specific site searches were actually for people looking for video sites. Many of the people looking for specific apps or software to download were actually looking for pirated stuff like wares. Proxy and unblocker sites. Monday through Friday, there are kids in schools and workers in offices that are trying to figure out a way around the web filter, all right? Always zero hits on those things for the bad guys on Saturday, Sunday, and holidays. But again, the bad guys know there will be people searching for this, and so they're there ahead of them with the sites. Since it was the fall season, I looked at Halloween, Thanksgiving, and Christmas as the holiday category. And the interesting thing was that we have a code. It's a Malnet ID code that we put out for each of these that we find. And I was noticing that for the holiday searches that led to SCP attacks, it was the same couple of link codes or the same ID codes showing up. So there are actually subnetworks of SCP attackers who specialize in holiday data. So year-round, if you go and search for a Halloween costume or a Christmas recipe or something like that, odds are pretty good you'll run into one of the bad guys who's trying to poison your computer. If I were redoing this, I would have broken out two other categories. Health and medical showed up a lot. And sample letters. Sample letters are kind of fun. There are people out there who need to write a formal letter. Maybe it's a letter to the child's principal, letter to their manager, a letter to a friend going through a divorce. They're not comfortable if they know how to express that right or structure the letter right if it's a formal letter. So they Google sample letter for a friend going through divorce, and then they use that as a template for their letter. Guess what? There are a couple of search engine poisoning networks who target sample letter searches day after day, and they get a few people every day just doing that. Last thing I want to drill into, celebrity searches. This was interesting, 2.7%. And kind of one of the things that we all know about search engine poisoning is the bad guys love to target celebrity searches. In fact, in the RSA welcome packet this year, there was some material from a security company that mentioned, hey, the five most dangerous celebrities to search for this year were, and they named the five celebrities. And so I looked at this, I said, just 2.7% of the SCP attacks were targeting celebrity searches. Why is that? Well, again, this is not 2.7% of all searches conducted were for celebrities. No, this is searches that somebody put in where they saw a link in the top results, they were fooled by it, they clicked it, right? So they were actually victimized, or they would have been had we not stopped it, by an SCP attack where the search terms were celebrities, okay? The key point here, when I said celebrity search, these are not people you've ever heard of. This is kind of counterintuitive. I had to Google these names because I hadn't heard of them to see who they were and decide, is this a porn star or is it like some local TV news anchor from Des Moines or something? And so the A-list names, if they ever showed up in an SCP attack, it wasn't just Angelina Jolie. It was the celebrity name plus some porn terms, okay? So those were not celebrity searches. Those were porn searches. They went into the porn bucket, okay? And so if you stop to think about it, the only explanation I could come up with this in thinking about this for weeks is that there are so many real sites with lots of celebrity content on them that it's really hard for the bad guys to consistently get poisoned links on those topics into the top results. The last thing I looked at in the research was I wanted to measure the ratio of text-based SCP attacks versus image-based attacks because, again, I'd started to worry a little bit about it's going to be harder for the search engines to keep the image poisoning out of their results. But in a big sample of several thousand, almost 7,000 SCP attacks, less than 5% were image-based. There are a few points there. Lower ratio of non-English, higher ratio of porn. Hey, there it is. Much higher ratio of celebrity searching, almost four times higher for a successful celeb-based SCP attack on the image side than the text side. And if you think about it, when you do a text search in a search engine, you typically get 10 results on the first page. It's pretty rare for most people, I know it is for me, to go very deep beyond that first page of results. But when you do an image search, there are typically 24 to 30 thumbnail images there in your browser to start with. And unlike the text searches, the page keeps going. You can just turn your little scroll wheel and quickly scroll down through dozens and dozens and dozens more images with very little effort, and your eye is really good at parsing visual information like images. And so in that kind of environment, it's easier for the bad guys to get a distinctive image to show up and have people click on it. I concluded the RSA presentation with some defensive suggestions, and very briefly, three areas. User education. We can't make our users into security experts, true, but it's very common to meet a user and ask them, are you aware that clicking on things in your email inbox can be dangerous? And they'll say, yes, I know about those kinds of things. How many of you know that clicking on a link for an innocent search in Google or Bing can be just as dangerous? And no hands go up. So that's the level of awareness I'm talking about. Just make users aware this can be just as dangerous as email. Web filtering, I've suggested some of the categories that are more dangerous than others. Last thing, secure your sites. Don't become part of the problem. The bad guys love to host their SCP content on somebody else's site because Google and Bing already know that site and they trust it. And you don't want to be blacklisted by a search engine because then why do you even have a website? Thank you. I think at the time you actually see this video on the podcast, we'll have a Q&A session afterwards. And so I'll hope to take some questions then. The detail for this research is on our blog, bluecoat.com/security. And I'll try to get all that research up again by the time this actually goes out live. Thank you.